Honorable Ansari Sahab, Justice Chelameshwar, Nayantara Ji. Everybody has very strong views about media because it's a daily infliction in the life of each one of us. And everybody has very elaborate solutions, questions about what is wrong with the Indian media. So let me try to impose a certain kind of analytical discipline here and make one broad, very broad proposition. And the proposition is this, that the nature of Indian media has continuously changed as the nature and content of Indian democracy has changed. Because it was and is a democratic institution and is very much a part of politics. And it's also important to keep in mind that media's role keeps changing in a certain global context. And then there is a new, has always been a technological context. Now, what does media do? There is something of a core to the art and craft of media. For all times, in all places, especially in a democratic context. And that core means that media is deemed to be an institution, a democratic institution, and it performs institutional role independent of the rulers of the day, and that role involves educating people, guarding freedom, watching government, challenging its narratives, questioning its facts, its interpretation of those facts. It also involves unmasking abuse of discretion, misuse of office, neglect of duties. And I would also add that increasingly, the media also has an obligation to provide a space for dissent, for democratic dissent and a multiplicity of voices. And though many of us seem to be depressed at the current state of media and its so obvious inadequacies, it needs to be recognized that there has always been, always, a kind of tension between the state and the media. And the nature of that tension is invariably subject to contestation. I submit that in order to understand the state of the Indian media today, it cannot possibly be understood without a brief recollection of its past habits and traditions. When India became a free nation in 1947 and then a republic in 1950, the Indian media was very much in awe of the group of people who came to occupy positions of authority and power. In fact, the media neither had the credentials nor the conscience to carve out for itself any kind of autonomous sphere, leave alone entertain any thought of an adversarial rule for itself. The mismatch in terms of social prestige and moral luster between the authority and the media was overwhelmingly stark. After all, the authority was being manned by very, very tall men and women who had a sterling record of waging a glorious, sustained fight against the colonial regime. Nehru, Gandhi, Patel, Ambedkar, Maulana, and many others had an aura around them, and I concede they deserved every bit of that aura. Each one of them was more erudite, more scholarly, more noble, more saintly than any editor or journalist around at that time. The nationalist leadership itself was acutely aware of the importance of getting the story out. And it had, people like Nehru had acquired a certain degree of expertise in getting his point of view across to media within the country, outside the country. And they recognized the role of the nationalist newspapers. There were the Hindustan Times, Leader, Pioneer, National Herald, Harijan, the Tribune, the Hindu. All were self-styled nationalist newspapers who saw themselves in opposition to imperial voices like the Statesman of Calcutta, the Times of India, Bombay, and Civil Military Gazette of Lahore. So, even before 1947, there was a sense of partnership, mutual respect between national leadership and most influential newspapers. And after 1947, the relationship got defined at three levels, I suggest. First, Nehru had genuine respect for newspapers and newsmen. And as I added earlier, he was not above using, even manipulating, Western journalists to advance the cause of Indian freedom. He himself has set up National Herald to put across his point of view, as Gandhi has set up Harijan. Second, there was respectability of the freedom struggle gave to the political leaders and administrators. And they had a moral chip on their collective governmental shoulder. And thirdly, the media, institutionally and individually, fully subscribed to the legitimacy of nation-building project that the new political leadership has undertaken. So it can be easily suggested that except for a minuscule fringe, the dominant mainstream media readily and joyfully subscribe to what is now generally referred as the Nehruvian consensus. The media leaders could not remain uncontaminated by that air of excitement that a new nation was being put together and a new glorious destiny was beckoning us, and that it was quite kosher for all of them to become part of that story. And it is also necessary to note that most of the political quarrels and politicking took place within the Congress Party. And as we do know, there were groups and factions within the Congress. So it was very natural that political correspondence would become close, even to the extent of becoming a close confidant of this or that leader within the Congress. And in the States, the regional media forges its own rights of intimacy and convenience with tall leaders like Gunvalla Pant, Kamraj, B.C. Roy, etc. And I think it's important to remark that for the first two decades, almost all the political disputes and arguments were taking place rather lopsidedly among the Congress, Socialist, Communist, and later Swatantra Party people. And these disagreements were conducted with a certain degree of sensitivity that was so characteristic of the Englishman. In fact, I always thought that the first 20 years we were ruled by Englishmen. They all had English training, English education, and to them, you know, a good paragraph in New Statesman was far more worth than a good editorial in the Hindu. What it meant was, well, there was a sanctity to the written and spoken word. There was respect for the political rival, and there was genuine effort at persuasion rather than railroading. This inclination on the part of political leadership brought respect, recognition, and legitimacy to those in the media who had the skills to report, argue, analyze, and occasionally advise. Journalists became part of the national conversation. I mean, the Mr. R. K. Karanjiev, for example, he ran this tabloid called the Blitz. But then he sat down with Pandit Nehru over a stretch of 4 or 5 months and produced this marvelous book called The Mind of Mr. Nehru, a comprehensive effort in explaining within the country to the outsiders what the new leader thought about matters of statecraft. There was mutual respect among political senior editors and the media and the government people. Mr. Krishna Menon, Babu Jagdivan Ram, T.J. Krishnamacharya, they all had their, you know, favorites. They were happy to keep open houses. Journalists could walk in, look whatever was there on the breakfast table, you were welcome to join. And if there was a government file, please have a look at it. So the relationship between the media and the government or the state or the authority was one of collaboration, cooperation, co-option, and even collusion. But it's important that this was not, India was not left alone to sort out its destiny. We often tend to forget, at least now, that how demanding the Cold War was on India, like it was on any other part in any other part of the world. But within the democratic contestation, the global powers, the two superpowers, had their own were seeking supporters and supplicants. In 1958, a newspaper called The Patriot was set up with a very avowed left of the center with close ties to the Communist Party. And then many of us who are today somewhat depressed at the rampant partisanship in certain sections of the media would do well to recall that between 1959 and 1962, two editors, S. Mulgaonkar of the Hindustan Times and Frank Morris, they ran, supposedly at the behest of some American friends, a sustained anti-Krishna Menon campaign, created a situation where Pandit Nehru had very little elbow room, just like we have created an atmosphere today in this country where no prime minister has any elbow room to do any kind of business with Pakistan. So it was, and they eventually got Menon. So after Nehru, two successions, two wars, a split in the Congress Party, it changed India. The cozy relationship between the government and the media came crashing down. The split in the Congress Party, this war between the syndicates and the indicates, took its own toll on the media. Newspapermen and newspaper allowed themselves to be recruited in the new political tribalism and its partisan demands. Then came the emergency, which tested the stamina and resilience of the media as an institution. Post-emergency, a new righteousness took over the media. It valued its own anger, and righteous anger at that, much higher than the traditional concepts of objectivity, fairness, distance, and detachment. Editors, many editors, 1977 contested elections as part of Janata Party. So the point I'm trying to make, that the first 20 years of a mutual respect, relationship mutual respect had descended into a, in the 70s, into a very, very uncertain, divisive, almost corrosive relationship, both on the part of the government, but more importantly within the media. Media was no longer a united house. It took sides, and it thought it was legitimate to take sides. Though everybody went about pretending that they were doing journalism, journalism of objectivities, but the fault lines discovered in during emergency and most importantly post-emergency. Some people got branded as Sarkari, somebody has put Sarkari as a great independent autonomous voice, saviors of freedom of press and all that. That division within the media got a new shape when the Indian state reinvented itself in 1991. The state willingly vacated the commanding heights of the economy and in the process submitted itself to the magical wisdom of the market. But more importantly, in the process, they also surrendered the moral stature. The politicians, after 1991, no longer could claim that they had the legitimacy which comes from wanting to work for public good. Though they had the this or that set of group of politicians who would come and capture the state. But it was now the market which had was deemed the new source of legitimacy. And it affected the media, how media conducted itself. Media newspapers started the process of corporatization. And it the good thing about that new phase was that the new owners were very clear that they wanted to bring the editor down from the high pedestal. So today we have a situation in the country where there are newspapers but no editors. I would be very surprised if anybody can name for me who edits Hindustan Times or who edits Times of India. Very few newspapers. Till that time, newspapers were known by the editors. The editors gave a personality, a voice to the newspaper. That is gone. And today everybody, the editor, a strong editor is, nobody likes a strong editor. The government doesn't like a strong editor. The politician doesn't like a, the corporates don't like a strong editor. And if you have a different, very few newspapers have arrangements like a trusteeship, trustees don't like a strong editor. So everybody is, so the demise of the editor preceded the moral demise of the newspapers as a democratic voice in this country. But now the new phase began, I submit, let's say vaguely, on 9/11. The age of terror dawned. It took its own, it made its own claims on every democratic and non-democratic institution. So today we have, even with all the pretensions of a democratic framework, we have a garrison state, a church of national security. And we have a very large sections of the media who believe that they have to be the choir boys in singing the hymns to this new god called national security. We have destroyed universities and their autonomies. We have shut down critical voices. Newspapers have themselves undertaken self-censorship, all in the name of anybody can sell or in fact con any individual in the name of national security. So we have a very peculiar situation. Yet, I don't want to give the impression of being despondent. The tension between, as I was started my conversation, the tension between the state and the media is very, very old. This is not something which started in 2014, in June 2014. It is taking different shape because we are all afraid of the new technology, what technology is giving us. But technology is only the mechanism. The whole concept of rumor is a very, very old concept. There was a couple of years ago, a book came out, I can't recall the name. Its title was Writing on the Wall. Subtitle was 2,000 years of social media. Growing up in the walled city, we got our political education from the posters which were put up by political parties. Some true, some untrue. We heard rumors, especially I remember when Indira Gandhi was prime minister. She had just become prime minister. So RSS people would be the same degree, kind of salacious gossip, which we find so disturbing and disquieting today. We heard it at the time. So my submission is that media, the liberal voices in this country, liberal institutions, there is need for concern, but not for despondency. For every one bad egg in the media, there are two good eggs. For every one shouting anchor, there would be two sober anchors in the country. And the good thing about this, in many ways, I think, you know, many of us sit before a couple of English channels and think the entire country is buying into that gibberish, shouting, panicky, nightly performance. This is a English-speaking people's conceit. Just because few people in English can shout in an articulate manner, we think the entire country is listening to them. So English press does not represent, mercifully, does not represent the people of this country. It may have a certain influence, but it does not. Not that the regional media are shining examples of internal or external robust democratic functioning. But the very multiplicities of voices and platforms provides us a context where we should reiterate the core values of journalism, and find ways and means of giving comfort, encouragement to those who want to practice good journalism. Thank you very much.